Magandang hapon, umaga, gabi ho sa mga ating mga kababayan dyan na nagpapatuloy pa rin pong sumamba kasama namin dito sa ating pananampalatayan sa lahat ng mga tao na dumadalo sa online. Thank you po. Tayo po'y manalangin sa Panginoon sa umpisa. Panginoon, nagpapasalamat po kami sa pagkakataon ito upang sambahin ka, Panginoon. At muling matutunan ang iyong mga salita sa tulong ng aming pastor, Panginoon. Salamat po sa bawat isa na narito, Panginoon, at sa mga tao na kinig sa iyo sa online, Panginoon. Baspasan niyo po sila, Panginoon, at pagpalain niyo po ang mga tao muling makakarinig ng inyong salita. Pagpalain niyo po rin ang bawat isa sa amin dito na nagpapatuloy pa rin po, Panginoon, na sumasamba sa iyo. Salamat po sa lahat ng bagay, Panginoon. Pangalan ni
Jesus. Amen. 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 So we'll start our worship. Can we recite that as Psalm 92? You can read it. 1, 2, 3. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing the praises of your name, O Most High. In Tagalog, magpapakasaya ako dahil sa inyo, kataas-taas ang Diyos, aawit ako ng mga papuri para sa inyo. So a church is a place of what? Rejoicing.
Amen.
Okay, let us sing along with Francis as we worship him. If you are able, you can stand up.
Thank you, Lord.
love you, Lord. For your mercy never fails me. All my days I will heal in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will see how your goodness arrived. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every plan that I have made, I will sing of your goodness, O God. Love you, Lord. You have lead me through the fire, the darkest night. You were close like no other. I know you as a father. I know you as a friend. In the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I have made, I will sing of your goodness.
Sada,
granddaughter
Sophia
here.
Sophia Junior.
Sophia Junior. So we welcome you, Sophia. Thanks for coming, guys. So I will be continuing in the series that I started. What in the world is going on and how shall we live then? It's talking about the end times. We believe that we are living in the close of the age. Okay, you may not feel it, but the more that we talk about it, the more you will see that almost everything happening, not only here in the U.S., but also globally around the world, is lining up with the prophecies that are written in the Bible many thousand years ago. And that's the good thing, one way to prove that the Bible is the Word of God, because things are happening as it was recorded by many prophets in the Bible. So I discussed to you last Sunday, I discussed to you about the economic, the financial prophecy of the economic chaos, that a time is coming, it's happening now. We have all the technology now that sooner or later, I think many of us will be still alive to see this, that there will be a cashless society. The Bible tells us that there will be a person who will rule the earth, a one-man ruler on a one government, and he is the Antichrist, the enemy of everything that is godly and good. And he will rule the earth with an iron fist. He's gonna be a dictator, a totalitarian. And the Bible tells us in Revelation 13 that without the mark of the beast, of the Antichrist, it can be here or it can be in the forehead, you cannot buy and sell. So if you are in a business, if you are buying and selling business, without that mark, you cannot buy and sell. So it's interesting when John the Apostle wrote that last book of the Bible, the Revelations, about more than 2,000 years ago, he doesn't have any idea himself on how it will be possible that a one man ruling the whole world will be possible. But with the technology that we have now, like in the palm of our hand, there is nothing, it's almost everything is, it's possible. You know, just in the palm of you, you can book your flight, you can do anything. The other day, I was thinking about this, it's almost Christmas, you can see that in the store, okay? I see some chestnut.
Yeah.
Yes. I don't know in Tagalog, but it's chestnut.
Chestnut.
Okay. Okay. But anyway, there's a lot of ways to cook chestnut so that it will come off the shell real nice. Okay. Oh. You realize that overcooked, it's not half done, but it is properly cooked. And I went to Google and it says how to cook chestnut. Just like that, in just few seconds, it gave me a number of ideas and ways how to cook chestnut. Do you know what? A lot of kings, even King Solomon, he doesn't have this access to what we have access in our iPhone. Almost everything that you can think of. What am I thinking when I'm not thinking? You Google it and then have an answer. It's remarkable, it's amazing about the technology, and the Antichrist will use all this technology that is available now to control the whole world. In fact, you can see that sooner or later, you don't need your credit card, you don't need cash, because it will be an obsolete thing. It will be a thing of the past. No, everything will be done in cyberspace, online banking, PayPal, you name it. You know, it's been a while since I see cash. When I was working, I never see cash, or just as I see, it was my paycheck stuff, and everything is in cyberspace, meaning it is in the internet, in an online. We don't see it with our naked eye, but there's reality. You can buy anything, pay for anything through the internet. So this is the second in the series, and I call it a cultural prophecy. But cultural means a way of life. You know, like this is different from one place to another. But there is this cultural prophecy that we call socialism. Now, this afternoon, some of you, it will be new to you that the name it says socialism is maybe new to you. A lot of things that I will be saying, sometimes you will even say,
what is that to me? What does it mean to me? But then, I mean, the Bible tells a lot about this thing that is about to happen and it's going on now, here, especially in the United States, about this socialism. This socialism, I will explain to you later. But the Bible tells us, it's interesting, a lot of things drastically happen just in the last few years, especially when this pandemic hits. A lot of it changed our lives. Almost everything in our lives have changed because of this. And that's why you can see all of those are what are bringing us to the end times when the world will be governed by just one person, being controlled by just one person. I may go ahead from my notes. It's interesting that in America, 40% of the people in Congress, in Senate, even like that, I just want to make clear, okay, I have no leanings. I am not endorsing to you a certain party in our government. But as believers in the Bible, but as Christians in the Bible, we should be concerned of what's going on around us. Amen. And especially the policies and the laws that are being passed on. And it affects us one way or another. And yet the Bible tells a lot of things about this cultural change that is happening so fast in our time. And one of these socialism, do you know that 40% of people sitting on the right and on the left aisle, that is the Congress and the Senate, 40%, this is high, almost half of the people in Washington pay for socialism. Socialism without them. Okay, let me interrupt myself. Let me move so other people can see. And guys, if you cannot see because I am here, we can still have a lot of space that you can move. It won't bother me if you're going to move your chair because I'm using a lot of visuals here so that you will understand what I'm talking about, at least what I'm talking about. Okay, in Matthew 24, that's not 17, that's 37, look at what Jesus Christ said. In Matthew 24, the whole chapter of Matthew 24 is Jesus Christ's response to the question, what will be the sign of the end of the age of your second coming? And look at what he said, but as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Okay? For as in the days before the flood, that's the deluge, yung dilubyo, yung napakalaking baha, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. And did not know until the flood came and took them all away. So also with the coming of the Son of Man be. So Jesus Christ is likely, making a similarity, a similar happening of the attitude of people that will be before he comes. And he says it will be in the days of Noah. So for us to understand what went on in the days of Noah, do you find that in Genesis chapter 6 and up to 9? But look at what Genesis chapter 6, 5 to 11 and 12. And this is what it says there. This is the days of Noah. Okay, this is when he was living. The Lord saw, nakita ng Panginoon, that the wickedness, depravity of man was great on the earth, and that every imagination or intent of the thoughts of his heart were only evil, continually puro kasamaan. Dahil pati na yung iisip niya, puro kasamaan. The earth also was corrupt. You can see corruption in every institution, in every part of our society. The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with what? With violence. Ano nagiging mga mararahas yung mga tao? And God said to Noah, "The end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence, and socialism will always breed violence." And as we go, you will understand that. And it says, violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Now in Timothy chapter 3, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1, this is what Paul said, and he describes how the end times, how the last days will be. And he says, but understand this, ano, unawain ninyo ito, but understand this, that in the last days, dangerous times, okay, dangerous times, so we're living in a dangerous time, of great stress and trouble. Have you experienced stress? sometimes at home, sometimes in the family, or so. When you see prices going up, it's very stressful, especially when you don't have much to buy commodities. Every time you pump gas, okay, it's kind of what? It hurts. And then it says, of great stress and trouble will come, difficult days that will be hard to bear. That means you will not have, if you don't have God, it will be more terrible for you because there is no help, there is no hope, and there is nothing good inside. Everything seems to be gloom and doom. And this is what characterized the days back then and much in our time. As it's like in the days of Noah, it will be a troublesome day. Now in Revelation, I just want to reiterate this. I mentioned to you that there will be a one ruler, a one government that will be ruled by one person, and it's now possible. Look at what it says in Revelation chapter 13, verse 3 and 7. Now we're talking about the Antichrist, that one person that is about to be revealed when we are raptured. That guy will be revealed to all the world. Okay, the whole world, it says the whole world, see? The whole world marveled at this miracle and gave allegiance to the beast. Now the beast is not really yung halimaw or frightening a creature, but it's one of the description or the title of the Antichrist. He's a beast because what? He is what? He is violent, he is what? He is ruthless. Ano? Ayon sa Bible, they will give allegiance, that means they will follow him, they will obey him. In verse 7, and he, the Antichrist, was given authority. Look at that. The authority is coming from Satan himself. Okay? From Satan himself. He says, and the Antichrist was given authority to rule over every tribe and people and language and nation. So this is one world government and one leader. Okay? And then in chapter 12, verse 9, so the great dragon, that's Satan himself, that's one of his titles, the dragon. Okay? So the great dragon was cast out. He was cast out of heaven. That was Lucifer, and he became Satan, which the word Satan means enemy or adversary. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old, that serpent who tempted him, Adam and Eve. Ano yung ulupong, ahas. God, the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world, see? This Antichrist will deceive the whole world. And if you do not know the truth, then you can easily be driven away to want to believe lies. 13 verse 4, and he, the Antichrist, deceived all the people. You see, all the people who belong to this world. And that's why I spend effort, I spend some most of my time studying so that I can teach you what this book is saying. Okay? This book contains the truth from the Word, the truth from God, and the entirety of this is truth in itself. Okay, there is no margin of error in this. If you want to know about where you're going after you die, or where who is the one that we should put our allegiance to, Jesus Christ, it's all in this book, and a lot of other good things is in this book. And this is the Antichrist. I know somebody came to me last Sunday, says, I recognize the face, it looks like one familiar face. I'm not going to go to that. The Antichrist, okay? Now the word anti, it means against or instead of. Because this guy here will deceive millions of people and pretend that he is Jesus Christ. Okay, he can do miracles, he's very eloquent, he's very charismatic, okay, and he will rule about 7 years time. And by the time that he is ruling and wreaking havoc on this earth, wala na tayo. We are all taken in the rapture. Okay, look at Colossians. It says there, beware lest anyone, okay, mag-ingat kayo, drop na kami dumating. Beware lest anyone cheat you. Kayo ay lindangin, cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit. Socialism is philosophy and it is deceit. It is deceitful, it's a lie. Okay? According to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ, in Tagalog, okay, Tagalog, mag-ingat kayo ang hindi kayo magalap ng walang kabuluhan at mapandayang filosofiya. Hindi Tagalog yun. Yung usap lang ko yun. Mag-ingat kayo ng hindi kayo madala ng walang kabuluhan at mapandayang filosofiya. Okay? And this is mga tradisyon lang ito at mga pamamaraan ng mundo at hindi mula kay Kristo. So there is this deception that is coming to this earth, and one of that I will discuss this afternoon is socialism. Now, what is socialism? Ano ba itong socialism na ito? I chose the definition that is easier to understand. Socialism is a political, social and economic theories advocating collective or governmental ownership and administration of the means of production and distribution of goods. Okay? In short, everything is owned and controlled by the government. And that will include your properties. Okay? If this will go on, the socialism will go on, the government can confiscate everything that you have, even your bank account, even your house. Okay? And not only that, it is happening now that they're even controlling parents with respect to their children. You can no longer, parents, you can no longer raise your children the way you wanted, the traditional way of raising a family. No more, it's the government who will do that for you. How do you like that? But then it is happening. Can you imagine? 61% of people here in America, 61%, that's more than half. 61% of Americans ages 18 to 24, most of these are now in colleges, ages 21, 61% of them favors socialism. Okay, and you will see, if you will notice, if you have a teenager, I'm not stereotyping and telling that all of them are. Okay, but my point is, make sure that if you have teenagers, that you bring them to the knowledge of God, the Bible, bring them to church while you still can. If you have custody of them, bring them to church while you can still can, because the time is coming. Okay, that they will be, it is being taught in public school, socialism, but they don't call it socialism. Okay, socialism is the same as Marxism, the guy who founded this thing, who came up with this idea. It is also called communism, Marxism, and cultural Marxism, and socialism. Those are all four terms, which means the same thing. Okay, and that it is all it does. The government is in control of everything. Okay, there is a country, Venezuela. Okay, somewhere in Latin America, Venezuela used to be just about probably less than 30 years ago. Venezuela is one of the richest country in Latin America. Okay, they said that the per capita income of Venezuelans are almost the same. They are higher than Chinese and Japanese. They are almost the same as what we make and how we live here in America. Venezuela is one of the richest countries because they have a lot of oil mines, oil reserves. Okay, so they were very rich. But in 1998, they elected this guy Hugo Chavez. He's dead now. He died in 2013. Hugo Chavez introduced socialism, like the one in Russia and Cuba, okay, in Venezuela. And look at what happened now. In less than 30 years, Venezuela now, 96% of Venezuelans living below the poverty line. You know how much a poor roll of paper towel costs in Venezuela? More than 1 million bolivars. That's their money. So I don't know if they're just wiping their butt. Okay? Are you still there? I'm not in my introduction yet. And that's, and you can just go, and you can just go. The socialism bill, there is no country, there's no socialist country that ever succeeded, that has never given freedom to any of their citizens, that has given them opportunity to succeed, an opportunity to choose who they will worship, where they worship, how they will worship. They are not given that. It will all be taken away. And you can see that happening right here in the US of A. I'm having goosebumps and I'm having acid reflux every time I'm looking at this and studying this, because some people think, what is that to us? What is Venezuela to us? How does it affect me? It is affecting us. It will affect us. Okay? On what is going on here in the United States. And we know that the U.S., because of who we are and what we are, the whole world looks at us. Okay? There is no nation so great as America. I'm just wondering why a lot of people here hate America when there are a lot of millions and millions of people coming all over the world who wants to come here. Okay? Because you have more opportunity here, but that opportunity is little by little being taken away from us. Okay? So in that is socialism. It means that government owns and controls the state. They sometimes call it the state, but that's everything about us. Okay? And then I'll go to the root of socialism. Yung pinagmulan po nitong kaisipan nito, no other than this guy. This guy is Karl Marx. He was a German, but he lives most of his life in London. Okay, he is the one who wrote those Bible for the communists. The Communist Manifesto is just a pamphlet, but Das Kapital. Das Kapital is German. Because he is against capitalism, the another government which I will not go. No, he hates capitalism. Capitalism is like what we have here, that everyone, rich or poor, are given an opportunity to succeed, to fulfill their dreams, and to express their freedom. Okay, he hates that. And you know that guy, Karl Marx, he hates society. In fact, he himself is unemployed. In fact, his son wrote him a letter one time and he says, "Dear Devil," that's his son. And then his wife, Jenny, I forgot the name of his wife, committed suicide because he cannot tolerate anymore the evil of this person. And even this person is a confessed demonic worshiper, and even his friends, angels, okay? Who controlled, that's the name, that's his friend. He said that I believe that 10,000 demons are holding the head of Karl Marx. This Karl Marx is the one who said in his book that religion is the opium of the people. What do you mean opium of the people? We are just being hallucinated. We are not in our right mind if we are worshiping God. Not only that he hates, he's not an atheist. An atheist is somebody who does not believe in the existence of God. He's not an atheist. Okay, he believes that there is God, but he hates God, and he wants everything that concerns God, and he wants to dethrone God from heaven, and that's him. You know what? There's a lot I can say about this guy, and he is the one being followed until today. It is about 140 years since he died in 1883, and he was buried in a cemetery in London that is known that as a cemetery for demons. Okay, and this guy was so dirty, he's got boils and warts all over his body, and his house that he's renting is so filthy that he has to be evicted by his landlord because they cannot stand the stench. That's how he lives. Okay, that's how he lives, and he's just begging money from his parents and from his friends. He said, and yet, a lot of intellectuals in our time and even back then are following his demonic teaching. I can say demonic teaching of the Communist Manifesto. That's the one that they're following, okay? And then the Das Kapital, that other book. And that's it, and that's him. He hates God. He doesn't like God. And in his teaching, and I will go on to that next, I don't know what to get. And look at this. Don't you see them in the news? Bernie Sanders from Vermont. During the 2020 primary election for president, he almost won the Democratic ticket. It's also the team. He said that I'm a socialist and everyone knows it. And all of this Green Deal infrastructure, this trillions of dollars that you see, that's what Green Deal, okay, deep state, and all those are just socialist terms. Okay? That they want to change our law, to change our way of life, to be what? And look at that other girl. Her name is AOC. That's the acronym for Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, the youngest representative ever elected from New York. He's just from New York. And he is an avowed member of the Democratic Socialists of America. And the sad thing is, he's got millions and millions of followers. And they believe that she's one of those controlling whoever is ruling in Washington. This girl, that young girl there, AOC, Alexandria, she is a very powerful young person, and she is a member of the, and she's got a lot of powers, and the sad thing is she may run for president in the near future. And she said that when she becomes a president, this will be like Venezuela, the United States of America. Okay, and the other thing that they hate this gathering. No, that's why I keep on saying, and I'm begging you to please, as much as you can, that you can, if you still can, attend church. Because socialism is the person that they will eradicate and eliminate is God, the church, and us believers. One of these days we can no longer use Facebook. Okay? Because we are religious, and they're just going to black out and just cancel us out. Because we are if they feel and if nararamdaman nila na tayo ay kontra doon sa kanilang pinaninindigan, and which is what that, they don't usually use that, the word communism, because alam nila, it's very offending to anak. But then a lot of people now in America is what? Is approving and accepting that form, socialism. The next, Marxism is anti-God. Okay, you can never say I'm a Christian and at the same time I'm a socialist. You cannot, because there are two opposite things. They are anti-God. In fact, the first thing that they do when the Marxists came over in Europe, in China, and in Russia, the first thing that they want, that they stop is the worship of God. Okay? Marxism is totalitarian. Okay? And these are the guys who killed millions and millions of people. That there is Stalin. He killed millions and millions. In fact, he killed 6 million Ukrainians through starving. Okay? This is who? Adolf Hitler, who killed what? Almost 7 million Jews. Okay? And that's him. And they are all what? They are all Marxists. And this is Mao Zedong. So sometimes you say it's Mao Zedong, but it's Mao Zedong. Okay? And he killed millions and millions of Chinese. Okay, when he came into power, and he called it what? The Cultural Revolution. And this is what? Benito Mussolini of Italy. Okay, another socialist. In fact, this Hitler was impressed by him. And this guy is a cruel one. And this is Pol Pot of Cambodia, who also killed millions and millions of Cambodians not long time ago. You see, all of this are totalitarian. Totalitarian is a form of government of a state, where only one is the leader, and he is what? A dictator. He is the one who determines what is right and what is wrong. He is the one who determines what is truth and what is wrong. Okay, if we are saying that this is the truth, to them this is not the truth. Whatever they designate or whatever that they say is the truth, that is the truth. And are you, okay, I'm getting excited. Not only that Marxism is totalitarian, that is the form of government, and you will see when the Antichrist comes, this is the form of government that will suit him. It's like a tailor fit. Alam niyo tailor fit? Okay, if you want a dress that really fits the curve or your body or the suit if you're male. So this socialism, which is totalitarian in its nature, is the kind of government that the Antichrist will be using to control the whole world. This one man, you know, and they are very ruthless. Not only that is totalitarian, but Marxism is divisive. Ito yung nagbibigay mo ng hati-hati. Okay? During back that time, and even now, they said, there are just only two groups of people in the world, the oppressed and the oppressor. Ano? Yung pinagmamalupitan at saka yung malupit. But now, in our culture here in America, we are being divided by race. That's why everything is about racism. Officials, you know, some of the officials in our government, and this is the same as what they did way back in Europe, in some parts of Asia. If they are seeing problems in the society and they cannot respond to it with a solution, they always accuse everybody by racism. Everything is what? It's a racial problem. In one way, we still have some racial problem here in America. Yeah, I think, remember this. Racism is not a skin problem. It's not a skin. It is a sin problem. As long as people are sinful, they will always find a wrong with the color of your skin. And if we are Asians, okay, except for my body here, he's Asian in a very light skin. Okay. You have that massacre? Shootings in Atlanta? That Vietnamese salon? Okay? Have you seen that old Filipino lady? I don't know what state was that. She's being hit and kicked by a big guy who also killed his mother. And three people are just watching this old Filipino being kicked to the face right there on the street. So don't tell me that we are not affected by this socialism. Okay? Soon they will come apart. it's because of your race, because of your nationality. Okay, and then this is very divisive. I can go more on this in our later topic, but that's what they do. Now, contrary to what the Bible says, the Bible wants us to unite, but this Marxism wants us to divide. In fact, the family, okay? They believe that parents should be separated from their children. Okay, that's why in many communist countries, women are sent to factories to work because they are not supposed to be in the house. Okay, I'm not against a mom working, but to them, that's how they divide even the family. And more on this. Can you imagine if your children are taken from you and they said we're gonna raise your children? Okay. And then you have no more say about how, where, when you're gonna send them to school or what they're gonna teach them. This is it. We are very close to this. Okay. You've heard that word probably, you haven't heard that term, that critical racial issue. They already changed Bible textbooks in most of our public schools, and they are teaching about race, which is a perverted teaching. Okay, Marxism is deadly. They have killed more people combined. In World War I and World War II combined, they have more than double of the people that they killed. Okay, because why? Because Marxism, communism, socialism, they don't believe that human beings have souls. That's why if they kill millions and millions of people, they don't even get remorse. Because they think you're just an animal. It's just like killing a fly or a mosquito to them. Look at this. 1999, the Black Book of Communism attempted to calculate. Remember, these are not accurate numbers. They're just a calculation. Calculate a Marxist-Leninist death toll for the 20th century in Latin America. 150,000 deaths killed by socialist leaders. In East Europe, 1 million. In Vietnam, 1 million. In Africa, 1.7 million. In Cambodia, 2 million. In North Korea, 2 million. In USSR, that's Russia, 20 million. And in China, until now, in China, okay? 65 million deaths. And these are, like I said, these are just calculations or approximates, and they could be three times the number that I'm showing you on the screen. So Marxism is deadly, okay? Karl Marx, who is the founder of this ideology, he says that I want to eliminate all humanity on the face of the earth. That's how cruel this diet is. And the irony is, you have some intellectuals who are conforming, who is wanting to have this form of government here in the United States. Now, what does this mean to us now? Are you still there? Okay, look at this. Have you seen this in the news? The destruction of monuments? Have you seen that? And then they followed they pulled down and tear down the monuments in Portland, in many places, in many cities in the US, as some other countries has already imitated or emulated what is going on here. The destruction of monuments. Why monuments? Monuments tells us of our past. Okay? Now in the Bible, the word remembrance is used 164 times. Okay? I don't go back to this. I just want you to read, okay? That in the Bible, look at this, and there's so many places, and these are just the two that I picked, with regards to remembering what God has done in the past. Okay, because what he has done in the past, you can use in the present to encourage yourself to know that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Look at what he says in Joshua. After they crossed the Jordan miraculously, like what happened to Moses in the Red Sea, then Joshua said to the Israelites, in the future, okay, your children will ask, tatanungin kayo ng mga anak ninyo, pati mga apo ninyo, what do these stones mean? Yung mga stones na inipon niya. Then you can tell them, you can tell your children and great-grandchildren, you can tell them, this is where the Israelites crossed the Jordan on dry ground. What they say, it will remind them that God is faithful to us, God is so good to us, he delivered us from many of our troubles and problems, and he did that miracle so that we we will always be reminded, okay, of the goodness and of the power of God in our behalf as children. Okay? And then in Psalm 77, look at what the psalmist says, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago. So, they want to erase, going back to that, they want to deprecate, they want to vandalize, they want to destroy that, because they want to erase our past, our heritage of the past. And remember, the United States, this is founded by people who believes in God, who believes in the Bible. Look at the Liberty Bell in Philadelphia. It's all around the bell at passages taken from Isaiah. Okay? And many of our, In God We Trust, George Washington. You know, there's a history in why they put In God We Trust there. Okay? And all in all, they want to erase that. The second thing is not only the destruction of monuments, okay? There is the cancel culture. I will spend more time on this. The cancel culture is this, okay? There is no room in a socialist state, in a socialist government, there is no room for what? For disagreement, or there is no room for going contrary to what the government is proposing. So, I will read this. Today in our societies, dissenters, these are the people that doesn't agree, find their business, careers, and reputation destroyed. They are pushed out of the public sphere, stigmatized, canceled. Okay? Like I said, anytime that we can be canceled with the social media that we are using to do our online broadcasting, you will be censored. If you are saying anything contrary to what they are proposing, the law that they are proposing, you are canceled. That means that you cannot do a lot of business. In New Jersey, there was a school board in New Jersey, okay? And the school board director is saying that we will no longer celebrate Christmas and recognize Christmas as a holiday, Thanksgiving as a holiday, Martin Luther Day as a holiday. We will all eliminate all those terms and we will just make it what? A student holiday. No more mention of Christmas, no more mention of Thanksgiving, just a student holiday. And one mom from the back raises her hand and says, I don't agree with this. You know what the director, you know what the school board director says? This is not a debate. We don't like your opinion. What we said is already said. That it is. Can you imagine that? The mandate. Right? Here in America, we are so free. Mandates. Okay? You need to be what? You need to be vaccinated. You need to wear a mask or not. You quit your job. How many thousands of people already do not quit their job because they don't like the mandate? Mandate, what does mandate mean? That means you should or else. That's sa Tagalog. Ayaw mo, umalis ka. A time is coming that we cannot say no to mandate. It's either you obey or you die. Okay, now we are still free, a little bit freedom, and we can still say no, we don't agree to that. But there's a time coming, if you don't agree, you're dead. Okay? That's a cancel culture, I'll speak more about. Look at what in the First Amendment. Soon this First Amendment will no more be. This is our freedom. Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion. So in any way you want to worship, in what form or manner, you are free here in the States. That's what our Fifth Amendment says. It says, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, you can freely exercise however you want to worship God, or abridging the freedom of speech. But you are what? You are free to say your opinion. I'm not saying to be violent or to be against the law, but this is ours, okay? Freedom of speech or of the press or the right of the people peaceably to assemble. It's interesting, okay? Now in college football and in professional football, they can gather about 100,000 of them. No mask. But in New Jersey, until now, and in New York, until now, churches cannot meet in person. They cannot do this. They're still doing online. Can you imagine if there are only 12 members, they cannot meet? But in football, thousands and thousands of them yelling and yelling for 4 hours, and there is no rules against this. You can see the inequality. Okay? So let's see. The right of the people peaceably to assemble, that is our church, and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. If we have some complaints to the government, now, with our rights, we can easily do that. Okay? But time is coming that this will fuel taken out from us. How about this? The dismantling of the nuclear family, ang ibig kong sabihin, unti-unti inaalis na nila yung karapatan ng magulang sa mga anak nila. And you know this BLM, Black Lives Matter? The statement Black Lives Matter is what? Is correct, the statement. Because all lives matter. Brown, yellow, red, you name it. But the organization called BLM, the organization, their founder said that he is a Marxist. And they want to take the nuclear family, meaning that parents have no more rights to decide on the future in the education of their own children, no more. It is the government who will decide for them. And that's what they're doing. They're doing it now. Okay, as a prelude, look at this. God created the family. When he first revealed himself to human beings, it was in the form of family, Adam and Eve, and they had children. Okay? He created a family through Adam and Eve, and God chose to take a human place to Jesus Christ. When he came, he was born by a virgin in a family. Okay? Socialism knows that as long as the family remains strong, socialism cannot flourish. So there's an ongoing attempt to subjugate, to control, or to suppress the home to the government. And that's what's happening now. And it's kind of sad. That's why I said in the beginning, if you think what I'm discussing does not concern you, it concerns you. It concerns you. You know, a lot of people, parents that we know, they are very thankful, and it's good, they're very thankful that they are able to send their children to college, to pay their tuition in college. Okay? And that's a good thing. But what they don't know, if they will not influence their children to a godly life, the Bible, the church, and the Word of God, they are what? They have a graduate who is summa cum laude or cum laude, and they have all of this doctorate degree maybe, but they are godless children. See, they no longer respect their parents. How do you like that?
Amen.
You're telling your parents, oh, my son and my daughter, they graduated cum laude. Okay, and then their tuition. But they are what? They are irrespectful of other people in leaving us. They don't speak people, and they are not so much concerned about other people's concern or lives. And this is it. 61% of most of these students are what? Are for this. Another thing, there is the distribution of wealth, which is another, it's a lie. So what is this is that? They say, okay, we want all people to be equal. Equal, pantay-pantay, walang mayaman, walang mahirap. So what the government will do, I'm going to get all your businesses, I'm going to get all your money, all your property, and then we're going to distribute it equally to all. It will never happen. Why? Because these people who are collecting our money, our property, are corrupt and greedy. Sila lang ang papayaman. See? So the poor are becoming poorer and poorer, but the rich are becoming richer and richer. Tingnan niyo sa North Korea, si Kim Jong-un. Andiyo pa ba kayo? Hello, what is that there?
Amen.
Si Rocketman. Tawag niya ang Trump. Ano? North Korea. Millions of North Koreans are dying of hunger. Okay, that's why they eat what? They eat scorpion, they eat snakes, and they eat bats. Mga butike, at mga, ano yung bats? Panike. At ito si Kim Jong-un, whatever else his name, Kim. Yun ang pigido nila eh. He lives in at least 4 mansions. He drinks every day the most expensive wine. He eats the most expensive cheese coming from Italy. And he smokes the most expensive cigar in the whole world. He is living a life of a king while millions and millions of North Koreans are dying of hunger. And it's the same thing with many countries. So the rest of the citizens are kailangan pantay-pantay. I can say more a lot of that, but I have to go. Look at this. They see this in the news. Defunding the police. What do they mean by defunding the police? Get rid of the local policemen. You know, sinasabi nila. And look at the cities in the states which has been ridden there of their police. Look at New York. 38% crime has what? Crime has increased. Look at Portland. Look at Chicago. Look at LA. And all of this, we're heading to Minneapolis, where they're defunding the police. You know why they're defunding the police? Okay, let us rid of the police from the local level so that everything can be nationalized and federalized. So that means that even our local community will be run not by our local sheriff, not by our local police, but by the government in Washington. So unti-unti lahat ng kapangyarihan ay dinadala doon. You see the mentality now? Okay? The Antichrist is only one person ruling all the world. And that's why the Lord said they want to defund the police. Magulo na nga, aalisin mo pa yung mga police. Nakaupo po ninyo, I know there are some police that shouldn't be there. But that's just a handful of them. But many of them are really people who, as soon as they wear their uniform, they're there to protect all of us. They are putting their lives and their families at risk for our safety. And now they're gonna defund the police, you know why? Because they want to generalize lahat ay nanggagaling to sa Washington. Wala na to. And you see, a lot of senators are in favor of defunding the police. In fact, one of the mayors, I will not even go into that. I'm becoming handsome as well, as I'm getting closer to my discussion. Are you still there? Defund the police. They did that. In the early rise of socialism, that's what it is. So that all the control will be in the state or in that one government. And then another thing. Look at what the Bible says about authorities. The authorities are God's servants. Authorities, okay, all of them, from the president to the barangay chairman. He says, all authorities are God's servants, including God's ministers. Okay, send for your good para sa kabubuti natin. But if you're doing wrong, of course, you should be afraid. Okay, for they have the power to punish you. They are God's servants, sent for the very purpose of punishing those who do what is wrong. Ano, can you imagine you call 911 and they're gonna tell you, hey, you protect your own self. Okay? And it's happening in many countries. There is one woman in Virginia. She has her daughter at the back of the car. And a lot of mob are trying to batter and to destroy her car. And she is calling, and the police says, we cannot do that. Okay? We cannot do that. The police says, we cannot do that. Call your local representative. Can you imagine? They're killing us. They're all about to die to kill us. They're saying that. Defund the police. Now, if all I have said is, I will end in what I said is, I'm done with that. I got three more minutes. Please give me three more minutes. Then we're just going to go out here very sad and very lonely. But look at this. How do we live then as believers? First, let's review what the Bible says. So, let's review what the Bible says. Look at this. God is not against work. God is not against owning private property in Exodus. God is not, God condemns theft. Kung nagnanakaw ka lang, parusahan ka. Okay, look at what happened in New York, in Minneapolis, and in Portland. Those looters, see what they have in protest? A lot of people are just looting. Nagnanakaw ng mga tindahan. Okay, but pag kinulong, lalabas din. But the Bible tells us, it condemns them, thou shalt not what? Thou shalt not steal. It condemns covetousness and death and grief. And then God wants us what? To own properties, to own our business, and to have an investment. Socialism contradicts and subverts all of this. Another thing, refuse to live by lies. Socialism is a lie. Kasi naman yan yung kahit anong sabihin nilang gaganda. Bernie Sanders said, it is not the socialism that you see in Russia and in North Korea. He said, this is the socialism that you see in Scandinavia, Denmark, and Sweden. He is lying. Scandinavia, Denmark, and the Netherlands, they are not socialist republic. They are monarchial. Okay, meron silang king. Okay, they are not socialist, they are not communist. So don't believe lies. How do you do that? Just look at what it says. If a ruler pays attention to lies, lahat ng kanyang mga kaalipores, all his servants become wicked. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who do truthfully are his delight. So don't listen to the lie. Okay? And then the next thing, resolve to follow Christ and not just admire him. Ito na po yun. I know we are tired, I know we have a lot of reasons not to be in church, but I appreciate all of you because in spite of your schedule, in spite of your busyness, you still find time to come to church. Because look at this, we are not only an admirer of Christ, but we are the followers of Christ. We do follow him in spite of all our sacrifice, or we do sacrifice just to follow the Lord. Look at what he says. Okay, the world would love you as one of its own. So that means I got 5 more minutes. The world would love you as though it belonged to it, but you are no longer part of the world. I chose you to come out of the world, so it hates you. And then it says in Luke 14, if you want to be my disciple, look at this. Okay, you must by comparison hate everyone else. It says that to hate, but says in comparison, sabi niya, your father, your mother, your wife, your children, brothers, sisters. Yes, even your own life, otherwise, you cannot be my disciple. And that's a true following. You know, there is a cost to pay in following the Lord. Meron. Ano? And then verse 33, you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything that you own. So I'm not only fascinated or impressed by the goodness of Jesus Christ, but I want to be his follower. Look at this. Meeting small groups. We will do this next year. Okay, na lang, I get two more. Greeting small groups. You know why? When the time comes, when the government tells us no more gathering like this, it's easy to gather if you are just four. Okay? You can still continue your prayer. You can still continue your Bible studies. It's not so obvious. Okay? And within the church in Jerusalem, that's how they started. From house to house. Look at this. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house. You see? So it's easy. Like in our subdivision, we are at least four or five. We live in the same subdivision. We can easily gather together without being so obvious that this is a religious gathering if it is a small group. Okay? Look at this. They gather from house to house. They eat their food. We Filipinos, we like to eat. In fact, we're going to eat now after here. Gladness and simplicity of heart. Praising God and having favor with all people. So a small group. I will go on to that. That's very effective. We call it a cell group. Okay, and we're going to be doing that by next year. And then, second to the last, I think, resist any way you can. Obey God rather than men. When time comes, when the government will tell us, it is illegal for you to worship God. It is illegal for you to lead your family in prayer before you eat and after you eat. Okay, or to pray your blessing to them. When then the government will tell us not to do that, okay, we're going to obey God rather than human authority. This in no way is telling us to be disobedient. But what he's saying that the law of God is higher than the law of men.
Amen.
If the law of men makes itself higher than the law of God, as sabi ni Peter, we must obey God rather than men. Okay?
Amen.
And then remember Venezuela. Look at what happened in Venezuela. In less than 30 years, one of the richest countries, and this is what socialism did. They are drinking from the filth of the neighborhood. And look at this, that's all that is left. That picture there is Hugo Chavez. It's kind of 96% of citizens living in poverty. Most people earn less than a US dollar. So I'm done. I apologize, I extended a little bit. I think I'm lying when I said a little bit. But I hope you get something. If you are not a believer in Jesus Christ, if you are not a believer, this is the time for you to come to Him.
Amen.
And if you are a believer, but you are not really that intimate with Him, this is only a time to make a dedication of your life, of your commitment to Him. The only thing that will save us from this coming prophecy, this communism, socialism, Marxism, and you name it, is through Jesus Christ when He comes. Take us out before all the troubles that we are seeing now will happen to this. You don't want to be a part of that. You don't want your family, your children, your grandchildren to have a part of this kind of society, this kind of government that is soon coming. And it's happening. Thank you, Lord God. We thank you so much, God. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you so much, God, that even in this area of government issues, that your word has something to say, Lord. That the soon coming, the very soon coming of Jesus Christ, God, before that there will be a lot of these things that will happen. Lord, this afternoon, God, we don't want to leave this building, God, without accepting you as our Lord and Savior. I will not even ask you to raise your hand, but right there, you go to church, you know you have your religion, you know, but none of that will be changed. But what will be changed now is your standing before God and your relationship before God. Jesus Christ is not a religion. Jesus Christ is not a doctrine. Jesus Christ is not a dogma. He is not a philosophy. Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. And He is the only one who can save us from hell, from from the punishment of sin and from all of these evils that is coming in our days. So if you are here and you are not saved, you are not born again, and you haven't repented of your sin, ask Him now. Those of you watching online, if you are not saved, just ask Him now. It's so easy. Just tell Him, Lord, I come to You. You know my heart, and I ask forgiveness of all my sins. I ask You to cleanse me from all my sins and make me a person that is pleasing to You. Wash me, Lord, with the blood of Jesus Christ. And from now on, God, I'm accepting Your gift of eternal life that is only found in Your Son, Jesus Christ. He who was the Son has life. There is no other name given among men whereby we can be saved except the name of Jesus Christ. Accept Him now as your Lord and Savior. Take Him and then come and learn more about Him, that you will be strengthened in your newfound faith. And if you are a Christian but you are not that excited about your faith, you are not that committed, you are not that faithful and committed to Him, ask Him now, Lord, I'm sorry. For many times I am lukewarm, I'm taking lightly my relationship with You, God, by the reading of the Bible, the praying, and my studying of Your Lord. Ask Him, Lord, I'm sorry, Lord. I pray that You burn that fire in my heart to love You, to serve You, and to be a blessing to many more people. If that is your prayer, God has heard you this afternoon. And Lord, we lift You this country, this United States of America, Lord, from President Biden to all the senators and congressmen and all representatives, God, even all the mayors, God, in many cities of our great country, this America, Lord. We pray that You be with them, God, inspire them, God, influence them with godly things, God, that they will change their course, that they will still acknowledge You as the God who is in control. For every nation that acknowledges God will prosper. That's what You said in the Bible, Lord. A nation that acknowledges You will prosper. God, please turn back the hearts of our president and many of our officials back to You, Lord. Have mercy on them, God, so that we will live a peaceful life, a free life, God, and we can fulfill our dreams and the dreams of our children in this beautiful country, Lord. We thank God and we bless You. Bless all these people, Lord. I pray for all of them now in the name of Jesus, Lord. I pray for all of them now. I pray for the Williamson family, Your blessing be upon them. I pray for the Disuyo family, God, Jim and Susan and their family. You bless them, God, in the name of Jesus. The Marcha family, Lord, from Big and Ophelia and their children and their grandchildren, Lord, I pray blessing in the name of Jesus. Lord, our guest this afternoon, Banji, Lord, and her whole family, God, and even the business that they're about to start, I pray Your touch, Your blessing first upon their heart and upon their life. Keep them always safe and healthy, Lord. Just touch their life, Lord, and protect their life, God, and provide for them in the name of Jesus. For Anita, God, and her children, Craig is here, God, and Christine, I pray blessing, God, and for their friend Amy, Lord, I pray blessing and protection and good health be upon them. For Red and Annie, God, I pray blessing, protection, good health, God, and provision in the name of Jesus. For Auntie P, God, and her granddaughter who's here this afternoon, bless them and keep them. For Luce, I speak healing and blessing be upon them, God. And for Lutgard, the Lord, God, Anita's sister, I pray blessing of good health, provision, and protection, God, in the name of Jesus. However, I miss Imelda, God, and her family, I pray for Your blessing, especially, God, for Mia. I pray for Your touch be upon them and Your covering and Your guidance be upon them in that one family. So, God.
Mangamor,
Lord, I pray blessing of good health for Mangamor, God. In the name of Jesus, God, I pray that You restore him to health. In the name of Jesus, God, I pray that You bless him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. I speak wellness in the name of Jesus. I pray blessing for Manambioli in the name of Jesus and their family. So, God, we thank You this afternoon. We love You. And the Mareros, Lord, yeah. For Francis, God, they are a blessing to us here, God, and Rainboni. Bless them, God. Keep them safe, Lord, and Wayne, and Megan, God, and Mama. I pray for Your blessing be upon the whole Marero family, God, and their extended family. Keep them always safe, provide for their needs. And God, we thank You, God, for their friendship and the gifts that they are, the musical gift that You have given Francis, that he is using, God, to for Your glory in this church, Lord. So bless them in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank You. Amen and amen.